You're listening to KNOU HD2 St. Louis, brought to you by the Radio Arts Foundation. Programmed in St. Louis, heard around the world.
Well, right before the break, we wrap things up for the 8 o'clock hour this morning with Kabalevsky's The Comedians. As they say, if you can't beat them, make them laugh. And we heard Leonard Slatkin leading our wonderful St. Louis Symphony Orchestra. I'm Jim Doyle. It's 1 minute after 9 o'clock, and it's time for Friday Morning with the Arts, our weekly look at what's going on around us in the arts. And we have the great good fortune this morning to welcome Angela Ingersoll. She plays Judy Garland in End of the Rainbow, which opens tonight at the Grandel Theater and runs through July 1st. Angela, welcome.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, thank you
this
for coming
in.
First of all, I have to start this off by saying that you look like Judy Garland. I walked out to our lobby and I thought, oh my Lord, it's really Judy Garland.
I'm 5 feet tall and everything. She was 4'11".
Right,
though, you know,
right.
So it's not perfect.
You actually broke the 4'11" and you're 5 foot. Wow. Isn't this a stretch?
I've been told this my entire life, honestly. I started singing on stage when I was a very little girl, 4 or 5 years old. Judy was 2 when she started singing on stage.
Right.
And so there's been a comparison my whole life because I was this little tiny thing with this great big voice. And there's just enough physical similarities. God made me this way with the big eyes and the pointy nose and the crooked teeth. My teeth are crooked precisely the way that hers were.
Didn't even notice.
Well, she had to wear caps on her teeth, you know, in the movies at MGM. When you watch the television show later and things like A Star is Born, she lets you see her real smile. And I know how my real smile got that way, which was as a little girl sucking my thumb. And so I can surmise that Judy perhaps did the same.
So you have really sort of moved into the Judy Garland persona. You do a special on PBS.
Mm-hmm. It premiered here in St. Louis in March, actually, and I was able to bring that concert here for those who gave to PBS to support their local station. It was wonderful.
And now you're doing End of the Rainbow. It's been,
yes.
You've been in New York, you've been in Chicago.
Los Angeles, yeah. So this is a totally different magic trick, portraying Judy Garland in a play as opposed to my PBS special concert. So in the concert, I'm myself sharing stories of how my heart meets Judy Garland, where we live in the middle. But the play, I'm in replica costumes of actual things she wore, such as that gold suit from Valley of the Dolls and things mm-hmm. like that. And I am, you know, taking on the voice and the body movements, the very famous bit of stutter or jitter, the at once frailty and strength of this rather extraordinary person. And compassionately and responsibly talking about her journey with addiction. This is a really, really beautiful drama with very hilarious highs and very emotional lows as well that gets rounded out with great music. The backstage story of Judy's life in her hotel room in London in 1968, is when the play takes place. It's rounded out by all these concert sequences. She's got to go to work every night. She's got to sing for her supper still at this point in her life. And she's 46 when our play takes place. And Judy goes on then, as the title suggests, End of the Rainbow, to die the next summer in 1969 on June 22nd, which I did not know was today. you clued me in on that one.
I
don't know what day it is.
I feel like I'm looking for an aura in the room, maybe.
Oh, I feel like it's always on my shoulder.
I would imagine.
She's talking to me all the time. I was doing the play in Chicago, the first production of it I did, and I, in a very simple, non-dangerous piece of stage motion, broke my foot on stage. And I felt like that was her just tipping me over with her little finger saying, you remember who the star is here, Missy. Don't get too big for your britches. Because I was started receiving such praise. I mean, people have really showed a great outpouring of love for getting to relive and recapture her memory and understand more of her inner life. There's a lot of her psyche that simply resonates with me and speaks deeply with my own life experience and my own family history. I have loved ones who struggle with addiction. I have loved ones who've struggled with a lot of similar demons. So it's a night full of hard truth and lots of laughter, because that's how she wants to be remembered more than anything. You know, you were just mentioning make them laugh. She wants, you know, she was a clown, mm-hmm. really. That's what we love most about her. That childlike sense of play was never lost. And she was just so witty and funny. So that is all captured in the play, that wit and humor, along with plenty of tears and songs.
Yeah, we really have to point out this is a drama. This mm-hmm. is not a. This is not what you do for PBS. This
right.
is not.
It's
this
not
is not a tribute
concert.
Show.
No,
it's right.
No,
it's
no,
a,
no.
It's a drama.
No, there are three other actors in the play. One plays my husband, Mickey Deans. His name is Kyle Hatley, and he's a good friend of mine who I've known for many, many years. He and I go back to Memphis together. He was acting there when I was there for a short time, and I got married in Memphis years ago. My husband is also a performer. Actually, my husband in real life and my husband on stage in this play were once in a play together, in which they played Romeo and Juliet in an all-male production of Romeo and Juliet. So Kyle Hatley, as an actor, has the distinction of having made out with both myself and my husband on stage, which is a little odd, but true.
That might require another visit sometime. For
okay. I should have brought Kyle to tell
yeah,
you his
really.
End of that story. The director is a wonderful director from Chicago, David New.
David New, yeah.
Oh, he's a marvelous friend and artist, and just he tells this story with such compassion and such attention to detail and such he allows the actors all the freedom and spontaneity in the world. We've gotten many comments from I know folks who saw it last night, audience members at our preview, saying is this improv? It doesn't appear to be scripted, because there is such a sense of spontaneity to the performance. It's really exciting. It's not your mom's Judy Garland. I must let people know that this backstage version of Judy at this point in her life is a world-weary and hardened person at times. And there's a lot of language in the play because of that. So, Judy uses her harsh language, and she's got a drink in her hand a lot of the time. And so you're not necessarily seeing the beautiful girl that you remember anymore. This is a woman who's been through a lot, and the audience, it feels this need to just jump up and throw their arms around her and save her, because it's really hard to see this person who represents the child in all of us struggling so much. It's really beautiful.
Is that why Judy Garland still fascinates us? Is it the Wizard of Oz? That planted the seed.
The Wizard of Oz is America's first fairy tale. It was the first fairy tale written by an American author. And it's a wonderful story about learning to love yourself, understanding that the keys to your own salvation are within your own heart and grasp, that there's nothing in the outside world that can give you what you truly desire. There's no place like home, you know, and she's the face of that for all of us. She's the child in our hearts. So Over the Rainbow is an anthem that grows with us as we grow. There's a childlike sense of wonder in it, I know, for me when I'm 5 years old listening to it, as for many of us. But as she grew and sang it in concerts, when she stepped away from films and focused more on live performance, she let the song grow with her, and she told the truth from whatever point of view she was in that day. And if it was a bad day for Judy, she let that song be heartbreaking. It's such a great piece of poetry. It's such a great piece of music that it allows a lot of interpretation. right? So you have to wait all night in End of the Rainbow. You have to wait all night to hear it, because that's just how Judy would have wanted it in her concerts. It was always, you know, at the end. And when you get there, it's very redemptive. And it's, I can hear the entire audience crying. It's beautiful.
I remember a quote from Judy. She said, yeah, the Wizard of Oz was very important for me. And she said, and I'm paraphrasing here, mm-hmm. she said, I believe in the rainbow. Mm-hmm. I've spent my entire life trying to get over it.
Yeah.
Does that mean that she really wanted to put that away?
No,
and move on?
I think that her interpretation was, if she could get over it, that's the place where there isn't any trouble. That's what's on the other side. So it's if I could just have a sense of peace in my life, a bit of quiet. I don't think that she ever personally realized the self-love that Dorothy learns. That Dorothy finds the content by the end when she understands, I don't need to leave my own backyard. I'm happy as I am, who I am. And it's not a literal where I am necessarily. It's I love myself for who I am. I've discovered the greatest love of all. One of my other favorite singers, Whitney Houston. I've discovered the greatest love of all, and I don't think that Judy ever found that for herself. She was always searching. This play delves into and discovers some of that. You know, she was searching through her experience with addiction. She was searching with each of her five husbands. She was constantly looking for some other soul to complete her own. She never felt complete as herself.
Our guest this morning is Angela Ingersoll. She plays Judy Garland in End of the Rainbow. It opens tonight at the Grandel, runs through July 1st. And we're going to talk more with Angela in a minute here. We're also going to hear some of the music that you did for PBS.
Oh, wonderful.
And we're going to start with, don't even have to introduce these songs. You just play them. I think everybody knows them. And like I say, we'll talk more with Angela. It's Friday Morning with the Arts.
When you're smiling, the whole world smiles with you. When you're laughing, the sun comes shining through. But when you're crying, you bring on the rain. So stop your sighing, be happy again. Keep on smiling when you're if you suddenly find out you've been deceived, don't get peeved. If your husband bluntly tells you you're too stout, don't you pout. And for heaven's sakes, retain a calm demeanor. When a cop walks up and hands you a subpoena, if the groom should take a powder while you're marching down the aisle, don't weep and moan because he's blown. Just face the world and smile. 'Cause when you're crying, don't you know that your makeup starts to run and your eyes get red and scrappy. Forget your troubles, have yourself a little fun, have a ball. Forget it all, forget your troubles. Come on, get happy, keep on smiling. 'Cause when you're smiling,
Judy Garland, a.k.a. Angela Ingersoll there with When You're Smiling.
That's and that, the big opener from Carnegie Hall. I love it.
And that performance was you on PBS, if
correct.
I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. I do sing that song in the play as well, though. So there's the opportunity to see it live at End of the Rainbow. And it's even more Judified. I mean, that's me, if I may create a verb. Me singing it more as myself without being able to shake the Judy Garland out of my voice. But in the play, it's an even deeper delve into the actual magic trick of convincing people they're really at a Judy Garland concert. And it seems to go over quite well.
So you mentioned while we were listening to that,
mm-hmm.
and I don't want to throw any spoilers out there, but you purposely tear that song apart.
Yes, I wasn't going to give that away, but let's. So this is in Act Two when I get to perform this song in concert, and we're seeing Judy at a low point. This is her roughest performance, and she loses her place a couple times. She's fighting with her mic cord and getting quite angry about it. So it's a song that I actually have to butcher a bit at the beginning, but of course, in her signature style, the big ending is perfect. She always finds her way. She is a creature of the stage and a creature of the spotlight, and somehow she musters the strength to inspire everyone by the end of the piece. And it's that over and over again. You know, they called Judy Garland the comeback queen, and like a phoenix, she would rise from the ashes. You would see her driven all the way to the ground, and there seemed to be such despair surrounding her. And she said, oh, no, and she would get up again and again and again. And and triumph, you know, at the end of the 40s when MGM decided to part ways with her because they felt that her behavior was too erratic. It seemed she was down and out and would never work again. And that's when she launched her concert career and said, I don't need a movie screen between me and the audience. I'm going to go directly to the audience because mm-hmm. people love Judy Garland. She wrote that through the 50s. And then at the end of the 50s, she was quite ill. Her 100-pound frame had bloated to nearly 200 pounds. And she there was fluid surrounding all of her organs, and the doctor said, you'll never work again. All of the substances, you know, had really taken a toll on the body by that point. But this is funny. I tell this story in my concert, actually, and in the PBS special. A phone call got her out of bed. She was lifelong friends with Peter Lawford, you remember, from mm-hmm. Easter Parade. He called her because his brother-in-law was running for office, and could Judy come and help campaign for that 1960 presidential election? So getting up and campaigning for Kennedy was what got Judy back in shape and back on her feet. And this was in 1960, so come 1961, here she is, arrives at Carnegie Hall for the great comeback concert, which was a quite make or break for her. She didn't sleep for, I think it was 3 days, before Carnegie Hall. She was so worried about her medications mixing poorly, and she was just so darn nervous. And she goes out and gives a 3-hour, just what is now referred to as the greatest night in entertainment. And it's amazing to hear the power that she has over the audience. It's a really beautiful experience. I have to recommend. It went gold very quickly, that album. It's never been out of print. Won tons of Grammys. It was a great triumph for her. Put her back on the map. And then, of course, she leads to the television show and riding up to the 60s. But by 1969, which is when we're seeing her in this play, we're seeing her at the end of 68, beginning of 69, and End of the Rainbow. That's when her little body couldn't really take it anymore. And we lost her at the age of 47.
Yeah.
It was just after her 47th birthday.
On this day, the 22nd of June in 1969.
I didn't know it was
49 years ago today. There is something magic here.
Mm-hmm.
Angela Ingersoll is our guest this morning. She plays Judy Garland.
Mm-hmm.
in a drama and sings. It's End of the Rainbow. It opens tonight at the Grandel. It runs through July 1st.
If folks don't know how to get tickets, it seems like MetroTix is where people go everywhere in St. Louis to get their tickets. So it's MetroTix, and it's also the producer's website, I'm sure they can go to as well, which is Max and Louie.
Max and Louie, correct.
Productions. Yeah. MaxandLouie.com will also help people find their way there.
Want to hear another piece here?
I'd love to.
And this is Come Rain or Come Shine.
Oh, this is my favorite one to do. This is just, listen to this drummer. Oh.
This is Angela Ingersoll. And this you will also hear.
Mm-hmm. You will hear this in the play as well.
This is the 11th hour, big one.
I love this song.
It's Friday Morning with the Arts.
Gonna love you like nobody's loved you, come rain or come shine. High as a mountain, deep as a river, come rain or come shine. I guess when you met me, it was just those things, but don't ever bet me, 'cause I'm gonna be true with you, let me. You're gonna love me like nobody's loved me, come rain or come shine. It was just one of those things, but don't ever bet me, 'cause I'm gonna be true, gonna be true with you. Let me, let me, let me, let me, let me, let me love you, let me love you.
Come Rain or Come Shine, Judy Garland, and sung there by Angela Ingersoll, our guest this morning on Friday Morning with the Arts. She plays Judy Garland in End of the Rainbow, running tonight through July 1st at the Grandel. And we'll talk more with, is it Judy or is it Angela? It's coming up next.
Gluck's cherished operatic masterpiece, Orfeo and Eurydice, comes to life at Opera Theater of St. Louis as part of the 2018 festival season. This all-new production features St. Louis's own Jennifer Johnson Cano in the role of Orfeo. Born in Festus, Missouri, she has gone on to give over 100 performances at the Metropolitan Opera. The New York Times has cheered her past performances, saying that dramatic intelligence and imagination suffused every note. In Orfeo, she appears opposite soprano Andriana Chuchman, who last captivated audiences in 2016's Shalimar the Clown. The production also features the talents of St. Louis's own Big Muddy Dance Company, whose dancers bring opera's beloved ballet sequences to life. Based on the ancient Greek myth of love lost and regained, Orfeo and Eurydice plays through June 23rd. For tickets and information, visit experienceopera.org. Opera Theater of St. Louis. Get closer.
9:27 on a Friday morning. Friday morning with the arts and our guest, Angela Ingersoll. She plays Judy Garland in End of the Rainbow. Opens tonight, runs through July 1st at the Grandel. And I wanted to ask you, Angela, you, and I said this earlier, you look like Judy Garland. You're 5 foot tall. Mm-hmm. Judy was four foot 11. Yep. Obviously, you've done certain things to sort of keep that persona going. You have to sort of look like Judy. You can't play this role night after night if you don't actually look
like her.
Sure,
yeah.
So you
a likeness
have,
is
so
necessary.
So you have some natural characteristics, obviously. Mm-hmm. Where did this fascination? There has to be a fascination. Yeah. I mean, this is your bread and butter. You're not. Yeah. You're really not doing, or you can tell me differently. But right now,
it dominates my time right now.
Right,
it
dominates your career.
It is dominating my career right now, which makes me very happy. That's a dream come true, actually.
So, where did all this start?
I was as a very little girl, of course, I saw The Wizard of Oz and fell in love, as so many of us did, 3 years old or something like that. But I had an uncle who was living in rural Indiana. I'm from Indianapolis myself, it was the late 70s, early 80s. I'm 40 years old. And when I was a little girl, nobody in the family understood why my uncle had this fascination with Judy Garland. And little old me didn't seem to care. And so he shared with me his collection. He showed me the TV show on VHS tape. And he gave me my first Carnegie Hall album. And that was the Judy that I fell in love with. Of course, the corseted, perfect, beautiful young Judy from the movies is delightful. But I liked 60s Judy. Even as a little girl, I was attracted to TV Judy, Carnegie Hall Judy, this woman who, this self-possessed artist who was looking directly into the camera and not apologizing for herself. And I said, that's what I want to be when I grow up. And I am finally old enough to be able to stand on my own feet and stand up for myself enough to say, yeah, I'm here. This
You're
is actually
it.
The life I've always dreamed of. And so it's a star I've always followed through my own life path. So I have to thank my Uncle Mark for that,
started?
Largely.
As a little girl, I mean, you saw this icon.
I was all children are mimics. I guess I was a particularly facile mimic. I credit my public school music teacher with being what I deem my fairy godmother. So my uncle gave me the records and things like that, and I was singing along, and my parents, even my dad, who worked nights his entire life, didn't ask me to be quiet because I was quite loud. So I have to thank them for putting up with a lot. I'm singing. I was of the Annie generation. And I go to grade school. I'm in kindergarten, and my public school music teacher said, "You have talent." Now, whether that was true or not, I believed it coming from an adult with some authority, and it set my life on a path of believing in something. I was the first person in my family to go to college. I come from a very, very blue-collar background, and there weren't artistic seeds planted in the community where I came from. But I had a star to follow. And so I have to thank my public school music teacher, and I think music education is just so vital. I was very lucky growing up in Indianapolis that there were performing arts schools. So there were a series of teachers who really helped guide my life. I then went on to, I went to college at Ithaca College, upstate New York, where I studied opera. I switched over to the theater department eventually because while I have a great respect for opera and I have a background in it to help teach me good technique, I didn't quite have the discipline to be as treat my body as pristinely, I think, as opera singers need to. College had cigarettes and boys and beers and things I wanted to try I had never seen before when I got there. So
the truth comes out.
Yes, I switched over to the theater department and then graduated from Ithaca College. Went on to New York right out of school, and that's when I started. You know, the first thing I did in New York, of course, is start booking work out of town. That happens to a lot of New York actors, and so I haven't been back for a while. I've traveled around to a lot of cities working, but Chicago is home. Chicago is where I'm based now with my husband.
When did you have your first chance to do or try Judy
to
Garland
Judy?
As an adult?
That's a good question. So I've done The Wizard of Oz. I did it, you know, maybe, what was it, 15 years ago, I guess. And my husband actually was my Tin Man. He was a very, very handsome Tin Man. They shaped his suit like a knight in shining armor rather than a big oil can. So he was very debonair. It was lovely.
Now, you were married at the time.
No, we were engaged at the time, actually. So it was even
so
nicer.
So you got to marry the Tin Man.
Yeah, Dorothy ends up with the Tin Man, everybody. So, you know, I had done that before, and so I've been in so many plays in my life, whether they had anything to do with Judy Garland or not. Audience members came up to me afterward and said, you're just like Judy Garland. I would do Carousel playing Julie, and people would say, you're just like Judy Garland up there. And I was like, I'm going for Shirley Jones, but okay, thank you. So the likeness from stage distance has certainly always been noted upon from audience members. And I think it's because I naturally seem to possess and am attracted to characters to play and stories to tell in which a female character has a great fusion of fragility and strength. And that was Judy. You know, she's completely emotionally available and present in this moment, as well as full of passion and intelligence, that's the kind of roles I'm attracted to. So I think a little Judy was always popping out. I certainly didn't try to tell the world about my love of Judy Garland, because I spent a lot of years thinking, how dare I? How dare one put yourself in the same category of a legend, of someone so great? So I hid this thing in my heart for many, many years. And it wasn't until about 3 years ago I started writing a concert for myself. I wasn't getting the work I wanted in theater. And I said, well, you know, all of your favorite artists whose biographies you read tell you, you have to start creating work for yourself. You can't wait for other people to make the opportunities that you know are right for you, the stories you need to tell. So I started writing these concerts so I could sing Judy music and tell her stories from my life experience and my compassion for her life experience. And all of a sudden, my life was green lights. I made a wish on a Christmas star that year that I wanted to be the foremost interpreter of Judy Garland's legacy in the world. And it's kind of happening, it feels like. I mean, now it's nonstop. It's everywhere I turn. I'm finding opportunities to help spread the love and keep relevant this part of our American culture. You know, it's a shared history thing about this great American music that it's important to me, that it's not disposable, you know, that it's something that connects us. We at least have the common language of the Great American Songbook or these classic American films or even just The Wizard of Oz to meet one another eye to eye somehow, you know. I had somewhere else I was going to go with that. Sometimes I just start spinning.
While you're getting that thought back, does this connection, you know, the Wizard of Oz, that connection is so obvious and so I mean, it's written into, when you use the word history, right, or Great American Songbook, mm-hmm, that's such a given.
Right.
And that will last for years. Mm-hmm. I mean, children will probably still be watching The Wizard of Oz 100 years from now and enjoying it and making it a part of what they pass along to their children.
I had a phenomenal experience with just that. At the end of last year, I had an opportunity to go to sing in Milan in Italy for a fundraiser and do some Judy stuff. And it was terribly exciting. So while I was there, I was doing some supporting other artists doing in-school work with school children. And so when it was my turn to participate with the children, I sat on the floor in a circle all with our legs crossed, and I said, I'd like to sing my favorite song for you. And I began singing Over the Rainbow, and all of these Italian school children with English as a second or third or fourth language, probably second, I guess, all sang the entire song with me. They all knew it. I mean, ages, I think it was about 7 to 13 in that room. It was one of the most thrilling experiences for me. Oh, I know where I was going to go with the other most thrilling experience.
Yes.
I was telling you how since I made this wish and followed this star, it seems that the world is green lights for me. And I keep coming closer and closer to her. Somehow, through the power of YouTube, my videos of some of my performances were found by Judy Garland's son, Joey Luft, who reached out to me to do a concert with him. And we ended up in Chicago at the Arcana Theater, thanks to a producer named Ron Onesti. We got to do a concert together for Mother's Day, a Mother's Day tribute to Judy Garland. This was last year in Chicago.
Okay.
And I sure hope we can organize to do it again. So Joey and I are on stage. I'm interviewing him. And then we'll show a video of Mama singing a song. And then I sing a song live. And at first, that idea terrified me. We're going to put her up on the big movie screen, and then I'm supposed to live up to that. I don't think I'm being set up for success here, but I'll try. And it turned out to be really beautiful, actually, the movie element coming to life and then having a live element. It was balanced, actually, really, really beautifully. So Joey and I had to get our script together of what kind of stories we wanted to tell. So he flew to Chicago from Los Angeles and knocked on my door one night, and I opened the door, and there's Judy Garland's DNA on my doorstep. And my husband, who is a wonderful cook, made him dinner, and he cleaned his plate, and my cat sat on his lap while he told stories, and we had a wonderful experience together, just getting to hear his point of view and look in his eyes and listen to his heart. I mean, he brought memorabilia to share with me. He brought the Oscar statuette that she won in 1939 for her juvenile performances. She never got a real Oscar.
Right.
She had this junior one, but, you know, he had it in a suitcase and just pulls it out and says, you know, do you want to hold this? And I'm standing there. We're in our dressing room together, and I'm standing there holding this, and we're looking in the mirror, and he's like, just look at you. It was quite chilling. It made me really, really happy. She didn't, as I said, get the Oscar for any of her film performances. She was nominated for Judgment at Nuremberg, of course, and A Star is Born. And she lost the Oscar for A Star is Born, which is a phenomenal one-woman show on film. Lost that Oscar that year to Grace Kelly, mm-hmm, in The Country Girl, which I don't find to be as memorable of a performance personally. I mean, Grace Kelly got to be a princess. Couldn't they just give Judy one Oscar? My goodness. Silly. But I think we have a song from A Star is Born.
Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Angela Ingersoll, she plays Judy Garland in End of the Rainbow. It opens tonight at the Grandel, and it runs through July 1st. And we're going to hear a piece right now from A Star is Born. It's The Man That Got Away.
Yes, sir.
It's Friday Morning with the Arts. We'll talk more with Angela in just a minute.
Mm-hmm.
have lost their glitter. The winds grow colder, and suddenly you're older, and all because of the man that got away. No more his eager call, the writings on the wall, the dreams you've dreamed of all. Done you, that great beginning has seen a final inning. Don't know what happened, it's all a crazy game. No more that old time thrill, his you're on to, but fools will be fools, and where's he gone to? The road gets rougher, is lonelier and tougher, with hope you burn up, tomorrow he will turn up, there's just no let up, the live long night and death. Ever since this world began, there is nothing sadder than
Angela Ingersoll as Judy Garland from A Star Is Born, and she's playing right now in End of the Rainbow. Opens tonight, runs through July 1st at the Grandel, and she is with us in studio this morning. It was a wonderful performance there. That one sort of gives me goosebumps.
It gives me chills every time, too. That one, I feel like the little record player in my throat, the grooves of that particular disc are the deepest. There's something about that one that is the most ingrained in my physiology, in my body. It's just all the way deep down in there. I don't know why. That one just really is part of me.
So, Angela, as I've said a couple of times now, you look like Judy Garland. you have perfected this role. Or come darn close.
I like that I get to keep trying over and over again so much. It gives me great joy.
And, well, and that's That's the sign of a true professional, that you, every night
you
get better. And I'm sure that's, from the way you've described this, I'm sure that's the case. What does Angela do after Judy Garland?
Oh, what else do I do?
We must think about that.
Other things going on in my life. So my husband and I run a production company called Artists Lounge Live in Chicago. And we are very dedicated to keeping alive the great American songbook. And so we have a lot of pairings of artists who seem to be the artistic descendant, seem to be the torchbearer to keep relevant great icons in the modern age. It's much like you see in a lot of the great Broadway musicals of the past 10 years. You know, we keep alive the canon of some of our most beloved artists with bright, young, new stars at the height of their vitality, right? You've seen this with things like Jersey Boys and Beautiful the Musical. And Michael and I, we have a lot of talented friends. And so we produce concerts like my Judy Garland PBS special for more of these. And some of them have been to St. Louis. We have a wonderful singer named Evan Tyrone Martin, singer and actor who does Nat King Cole. And I know he brought his Christmas show here last year, and it was very successful. It ran for weeks.
Out of Westport, I believe.
Yeah. And, you know, we've got a friend that does a great Bobby Darin. And none of us are impersonators. We are people who were born with a likeness, people who were born with a piece of this artist in their heart, and they just shine the light on their heart for everyone to see of that piece of themselves. So they're very personal evenings of storytelling. First and foremost, it's about the storytelling. You know, we're all storytellers first, and musicians second, and impersonators never in Artist Lounge Live shows. But we can't help but have a likeness. You know, I don't try to stand there and sound like Judy Garland. I learned to sing by singing along with Judy Garland records. I didn't know there was another way to sing. I got some lessons later when I was much older, but by that point they couldn't break my habits. I was going to be as loud as I could. You know, that's what Judy liked, and that's what I liked. I like that old vaudeville style of singing where you've got to feel the sound of the voice bouncing off the walls back to you to know that you're alive. You know, I can't stand to be compressed, you know, or something into a microphone with too much technology. I feel suffocated. I got to feel the sound bouncing around the room, you know. And that's what's so great, you know, about the play is we've got this wonderful live band on stage, too, for the concert segments. You get the best of both worlds. You've got the drama, the backstage story, the insight, the all of that surprise that comes from the inside story. And then you've got the concerts. We've got six extraordinary musicians in this orchestra. They're the same guys. If any of you folks out there saw me at Westport when I did my PBS concert there in April, it's my same band. They're so great. And you get to hear, you know, those bongos on Come Rain or Come Shine and stuff like that. And in this band here, they're all St. Louis musicians. And they're very dear to my heart, these guys. It's a very intimate thing we do, jumping off this cliff together. The music is very ambitious. It's very ambitious what all of us are doing together. And so I really love and trust all of these collaborators so much. And the music just fills my soul. It's great.
We started talking earlier about how you've appealed to children.
Yeah.
As a Judy Garland singer, largely because of The Wizard of Oz. Do you see a younger audience that also moves towards the 60s Judy Garland?
Absolutely. The singer. And I hope that I see that audience tomorrow when I will be stopping by Pride to help teach the children about a great icon in Judy Garland. I do. There are a lot of there are a lot of young people who, it's funny, are showing me my age. As I said, I'm 40 years old. And in the Chicago theater scene, it's such a vibrant scene full of young talent constantly coming in. So I'm meeting young people all the time who have started referring to me as Auntie Judy. And I guess that means I'm old enough to have experienced some things. But it's funny to be on the motherly side of the relationship. But there is a lot to learn. I think... I think the young, beautiful movie, Judy, is easy to put in a box, maybe, culturally, and think, oh, I understand what that is. That's very glossy. That's very pretty. I think from a distance, maybe a younger generation could think that. Though if you truly sit down and watch the films, you'll find she's a terribly witty actress. She's such a great actress first, and she can turn a simple, silly little fluffy story into really a great, great piece of art because she's such a great comedian. But particularly then when you get to the 60s, Judy, and it is more about a woman standing on her two feet, one tiny person against the world. This is the time when she's coming up to be a gay icon, and this is the time when, she's hosting her own TV show with a bunch of men trying to tell her what to do, and by gum, she's going to stick to her own guns and do it her way. And I think that that kind of pioneering spirit is something that, yeah, young people are attracted to today, learning about who are some of these women who are trailblazers for artists today.
Angela Ingersoll, she is Judy Garland in End of the Rainbow, opens tonight, runs through July 1st at the Grandel, and we'll talk more, and we'll hear one last piece of music.
Yay.
From... the girl who is at the end of the rainbow. Coming up next, it's Friday Morning with the Arts.
I still remember our first father-son cards game.
Now, I should have gotten half price, because the kid was on the edge of his seat.
Solid dad joke, old man.
Well, maybe then I could have afforded that extra ticket you wanted for your teddy bear.
Hey, now leave Mr. Snugglesworth out of this.
It's about more than a score. The Cards take on the Braves the weekend of June 29th. Get your tickets today at Cardinals.com. There's only one Cardinals baseball.
The Cards host the Braves the weekend of June 29th, and there are great promotions all series long. Friday, it's the all-over print shirt presented by Shane Company, and Saturday is the Carlos Martinez Mystery Hair Bobblehead, courtesy of AT&T. Sunday wraps up the weekend when all fans will take home a Cardinals bucket hat thanks to Coca-Cola and Powerade. That's June 29th through July 1st. Get your tickets at cardinals.com/promotions.
Hello, I'm Bill Stein.
And I'm Mark Schultz.
Join us Sunday on The King of Instruments as we play music in all the keys.
Tune in Sunday at 6 p.m. for an hour of classical organ music. Hear it right here on 107.3, 96.3 HD2, or online at RAFSTL.org, a service of the Radio Arts Foundation.
Just about ready to wrap things up for this session of Friday Morning with the Arts. Our guest again, Angela Ingersoll, who is starring as Judy Garland in End of the Rainbow at the Grandel. They open tonight and run through July 1st. Ladies and gentlemen, you have to see this young lady as Judy Garland and even as Angela Ingersoll.
Why, thanks.
Both quite fascinating. And boy... thank you so much for coming by today.
Thank you. This has been thrilling. Thank you for waking me up.
I think the cup of coffee you brought woke you up.
I'm not necessarily a morning person, but my goodness, you're so engaging and delightful. Thank you.
It's been my treat, believe me. The tickets are available again through MetroTix, or you can go to
maxandlouie.com. Max and Louie
Productions. The show only runs a week, so I highly urge you to get out and see the talent.
From what
that
I hear, it's pretty darn
around.
In demand, so I do urge you to go ahead and make a reservation.
Well, in the Grandel, by the way, I'm sure you've seen
such
it.
A great
it's
space.
An incredible space.
Oh, I love this space so much.
It is. It is.
Beautiful.
All right, so we're going to go out with one last piece. It's the piece.
The anthem.
And I know you can sing along. And thanks again, Angela. It's been a joy to meet you.
Thank you. And thank you to your listeners, too.
Kathy Lawton Brown comes your way after 10 o'clock. I'm Jim Doyle. Make it a great day, and we'll talk real soon.
is a hopeless jumble, and the raindrops tumble all around. Heaven opens a magic lane when all the clouds darken up the skyway. There's a rainbow highway to be found, leading from your window pane to a place behind the sun, just a step beyond the rain. In a lullaby, somewhere over the rainbow, skies are blue, and the dreams that you dared to dream really do come true. Someday I'll wish upon a star and wake up where the clouds are far behind me, where troubles melt like lemon drops away above the chimney tops. That's where you'll
what wonderful applause. I'll tell you what, and what a great, great chart that is. Beautifully sung. It is just exactly 10 o'clock. It just flipped over on this Friday, June 22nd. Good morning. I'm Kathy Lawton Brown with you. Like I say, Fridays are so much fun. Guests and all sorts of excitement around here. Let's make ourselves legal. We'll take a look at the weather, and all is well.